Well, there's a growing feeling that it's a good time to be a fan of hockey in the tri-state area. Keith Irizarry, Mike Johnson, as well with our guy from NHL.com, senior writer Dan Rosen. Dan, you cover these tri-state teams as closely as anyone. Yeah. Let's start with the Rangers, both of you guys. Panarin, just your takeaway from him signing and what that meant to the Rangers.
Well, it's huge. It gives the guy, gives the Rangers the guy that every team wants. They need the swagger. They need the confidence. That number one guy, the go-to guy. The Rangers have been lacking that. They haven't had it. They really haven't had it since Rick Nash scored 42 goals a number of years ago. Mm-hmm. And he's the guy. That's why they gave him this contract. They signed Panarin, the seven-year deal. And David Quinn, I think, said it best, their coach. He said, when you get a guy like Panarin coming in, everybody sticks their chest out a little further. Everybody's got a little more swagger because it takes the pressure off of other guys. And I'm really curious to see. You see the lines there. I'm very curious to see him play with Mika Zibanejad, who had a terrific year last year, coming off his best year. And the Rangers believe, and I think they're right, that he's just finally now touching the surface of his potential that he's had for a number of years. So Panarin, Zibanejad, if it's Buchnevich there, that's good too. He is another guy who had a good finish. And I think he could benefit also from Panarin being there. Panarin will benefit from Buchnevich as well, as a guy who's been around New York and show him the way a little bit. This is a big-time signing. This is the big-time guy that the Rangers need to step out of the rebuild and be a contender.
He better be good. He's the highest paid winger in the history of the game.
So,
but what makes him a little bit different than Rick Nash, who was a winger who scored a lot of goals for himself, Panarin makes guys he plays with much better as well. And I think that is the trickle-up effect that he will have that will help Zibanejad, whoever the other winger is. And that maybe is a little bit different part of why he gets so much value. But you talk about what every team wants. The other thing every team wants, to me, right shot defenseman. I think Jacob Trouba,
big time.
Less sexy for sure than Panarin.
$8 million a year?
But he might be more impactful for the Rangers and where they're going, because he is a really, really good defenseman. The contract would dictate that. He was never given the role of an offensive defenseman on the power play special teams in Winnipeg because they had Dustin Mufflin, a right shot guy who maybe is better than him at that. But lockdown, PK, plays the other team's best players. And I think in New York, we'll actually see some power play time, especially if Kevin Shattenkirk's not around as
well. He'll play the power play.
You'll be getting the full package out of him. I think he is going to be as impactful as Panarin.
Well, and the best thing, well, one of the best things about Trouba, too, is he fits right into the age group that the Rangers want. He's 25 years old, and he is another guy who's just touching the surface of what he can be. At least that's what they think, and I think it's too. He had 50 points last year. He had a terrific year with the Winnipeg Jets, and he comes in, $8 million a year. It's a lot of money, but he's your number one defenseman now. He comes in, you went out and you acquired him to be the number one defenseman. What a trade, by the way.
Yes.
What a terrific trade. They gave the Jets back the first round pick they got for Kevin Hayes when they traded him at the deadline. And they traded Neil Pionk, who was really a 6 or 7 defenseman, and they get a number one defenseman in return. They have to pay him like that, but this now lines up as a much better defense just because you have Jacob Trouba. It's a lot on Jacob Trouba. He's never had this role before. As you were saying, Dustin Mufflin was there. That is gone. That insulation is gone, so he has to be able to take it on, but I think he can't take this.
And I also think this might be the year we see the Lundqvist transition, not from a good goaltender, but just in his workload. I think Georgiev might start more games than Lundqvist next year.
Well, I don't know about that. I don't know if they'll go that far with it, but Lundqvist...
42-40.
But I don't know. I think Lundqvist might be in the 40s this year.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think he'll be in the high 40s, but I think he'll be in the 40s this year, and that's the important thing. I remember asking David Quinn this question at the end of, and Jeff Gorton as well, at the end of the season last year, do you have to monitor the workload? It's not... If you look at Henrik Lundqvist's workload in the last couple of months of the season, it was very light. Mm-hmm. Georgiev played. Yes. It was how much he played in the time
early.
From the start of the season to the All-Star break. He played way too much. They have to balance that. If you want to start Henrik Lundqvist 50 games, must be more balanced than it was last season. And they might take a hit early. I don't know if they're going to. I believe in Georgiev. I think he could be a good backup. But Lundqvist can't play more than 50 games this year, and he can't play more than... He can't play more than 30 before the All-Star break.
It's the offseason. You guys are in midseason form already. All right, so... Worse, same, better. If you say better, how much better? New York Rangers.
They're better by quite a bit. They did great strides. They've expedited the rebuild. They're a playoff contending team this year and going forward.
I think they're much better, and I think their fans should expect the playoffs this season.
New Jersey Devils did it. I don't know if it's fair to say, but did this offseason really begin and almost end with getting the number one overall pick? Like, did that just kind of give them that surge?
Well, it gave them that. It gave them the surge, no question about it. It's a luck of the draw, you know, and you never want to really be in that position. But the Devils have now been in it two of the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. They get Nico Hischier, their number one center, and maybe they got their number two center or number one, depending how you go with it. But, yeah, when you get that guy and you get that pick, now everything – focus becomes on you. You become a little bit more wanted, a little bit more interesting, and you get a little bit, if you're Ray Shearer, you get a little more confident to make some trades and believe that guys can come to you like a PK Subban and believe that this team can win because you've got that young future right there for you. So I think it was a huge deal, but he's not the most impactful player they got in the offseason. To me, the most impactful player they got in the offseason will be PK Subban on and off the ice.
You know what? You're probably right amongst the new players, but they're also returning a player who's like a new player. His name's Taylor Hall. Yeah. He won the MVP the last time he played a full year. So you think about it. The Devils, who have needed a spark on the ice, off the ice, all of it, they went out and got the best young player in the world, Jack Hughes. They went out and got the best guy not in the NHL, Gusev.
Yep.
They went out and got an MVP player in Taylor Hall, who's going to return the lineup. Yeah. And they got a former Norris Trophy winner.
Yeah.
Oh, how's your summer going, New Jersey?
Pretty good.
Unbelievable how much they've done. And they got, can't forget about Wayne Simmonds and others. Yeah. I mean, they needed a lot to happen, and they made a lot happen.
The key thing of making it all work out is Corey Schneider's got to play like a $6 million a year goaltender.
Yeah.
If he doesn't, they don't have much of, we're not 100% sure where their goaltending goes from there. And Johnny, everything can look great. You know, if you don't get the goaltending, everything doesn't matter.
But this was a master class in how to leverage cap space.
Yes.
Cap space and asset, they did a great job accumulating all these players because they had the cap space.
Clearly not worse.
Way better. Again, if Corey Schneider plays like Corey Schneider the last 2 months, then they will challenge for a playoff spot.
They will challenge for a playoff spot. You're exactly right. Taylor Hall coming back, he will have the most impact of anybody who didn't play in the second half of last season for the New Jersey Devils. He didn't play after December 23rd, knee injury. He's going to have the biggest impact, obviously. Jack Hughes, need to give him time. He needs to put some muscle on his frame. He needs some time. PK Subban's got to jump right in and be the impactful player that we know that PK Subban could be on and off the ice. That's a big thing for the Devils, too.
Jack Hughes doesn't need any time. He's going to be good right away.
He's going to be good right away, but he's going to be way better 3 years from now.
Legit.
I'm so excited to watch him play. All right, so last New York, New Jersey type team, the Islanders. Leonard gone. Lee is back. Year two of Barry Trotz. Where are we with the Isles?
Well, are you going to be the best defensive team in the National Hockey League again because they didn't upgrade their offense? And that's the biggest problem. You have to be, if you're the Islanders, a top 1, 2, 3 defensive team in the league, and you're changing your goaltender from Robin Lehner, who had a terrific season, to Semyon Varlamov, who can be good. We've seen him be really good. We've also seen him battle hell. Thomas Greiss, you don't want Thomas Greiss to have to carry it for a long period of time. Short periods of time, Thomas Greiss can be very good. But they need Varlamov to be way better than that.
Yeah, and he will be because he played for Barry Trotz's system and Robin Leonard was never near that before in his career.
Right.
So I think Varley will be better.
But are they
going
to be the best defensive team in the league?
I'd probably say no because it's hard to do that year after year.
Yeah.
And I like the idea if I was a player, I'd want my GM to trust us and want to return our roster. But they didn't really trust them that much because they tried to get Panarin exactly right. They'll be good defensively. I think goals might be a challenge. The one guy who maybe has more in him, Matt Barzal, who I think learned to become a better player under Barry Trotz. Now he's got to take that better player and apply it to the same dynamic offensive game that he has.
I brought up Evgeny Kuznetsov to Barry Trotz early last season. I said, do you see a comparison? He kind of didn't see it yet, but my point on it was Barzal is a terrific offensive player. He can fly around the ice, can do so many different things, like Kuznetsov. Mm-hmm. But when Barry Trotz sunk his teeth into Kuznetsov, he became a much more well-rounded player and a legit all-star.
Yeah.
And Matt Barzal is an all-star, but can he be that well-rounded player? I think he can be, and I think he will be, so I think there's more there. And they're going to need more.
Yep.
Look, they're going to need more because they tried in various facets to upgrade their offense. They're probably still trying to upgrade their offense. But they haven't gotten that difference-making player. They wanted Panarin. They thought they had a real good shot. They did, probably. But he went to the Rangers. And they don't have that difference-making guy. And that's why they're going to continue to have to rely on their defense and their goaltending. Yep. And because of that, I do question, can they do it again?